fair land of Britain, with its romantic countryside, beckons you to scenes of beauty and enchantment. And no traveller but the cyclist can appreciate so well the magic of its changing scenes, the intimacy of its historic buildings, and the glory of its peaceful rolling countryside. He can travel far or near. He is independent and free. Year by year, the attractions of cycle touring find wider appreciation. More and more people, young and old, leave the cities and towns at weekends and on their annual holidays to experience the thrill and satisfaction provided by a journey awheel in Britain. But not all touring is leisurely and peaceful, and there is more than one kind of tour. Pedaling hard to cover 1,600 miles in 12 daily stages are the 59 riders in the Tour of Britain, the longest and most ambitious cycling road race to be held in this country. Yes, it's touring of quite another kind, as top-ranking riders from Italy, France, Belgium and Britain strive for honours in a tough battle that takes them round England and into Scotland and Wales. It is a severe test of men and machines that has captured the imagination of the British public. There is all the excitement of a big occasion even before the tour starts, with crowds of Londoners flocking to Hyde Park to see the teams as they ride in procession to Chingford on the outskirts of London. Here the riders have a final check-up before the start of the first stage that ends at Yarmouth, 126 miles away. The race is neutralised in this initial period, and Londoners are able to have a good look at the riders as they start their long journey. The months of preparation by the organisers in taking care of the many details connected with the tour are now coming into effect. Route marking, marshalling, feeding and traffic control. Nothing must be left to chance. The tour is on and the speeding, colourful group of riders swing out into the open country. It's a battle without quarter. Man against man and team against team for the honour of wearing the yellow jersey that distinguishes the leader in the general classification. And there are some worthy contenders for that honour too. The helicopter gives us a fine view of the field as they speed along on the first stage. Here is Luciano Ciancola, world's amateur road champion of 1952 and probably the most feared rider in the race. And it's not long before the attacks start, with the continental riders well to the fore. There is a breakaway group ahead and Ciancola jumps away from the main field to catch the leaders. Through the feeding station with 74 miles covered, there are now 9 riders out in front. Behind them, the field chases steadily, followed by the cars and vans carrying spare bicycles and components. Although this is only the first stage of the race, with many more hard miles ahead, there's no half-heartedness about the racing. The breakaway group has a determined air, and at Yarmouth, there is the honour of the race leader's yellow jersey to be won. On they go, through quiet East Anglian villages, maintaining an average speed of nearly 25 miles an hour. Still, the breakaway group holds its lead, but as the 100-mile mark is reached, two more Italians, Monti and Gestri, with Englishman Bevis Wood, leave the main field and join the riders who remain at the front. And as they reach Yarmouth, it's a battle between the leaders, with Monti and Ciancola winning from Wood and Talbot, with yet another Italian, Gestri, fifth. On the second day of the race, the riders have to cover half of the stage as a time trial. For the 39 miles from Peterborough to Leicester, they must ride alone, without team support, matching their abilities against time. morning's mass start section of the stage, Chiancola beat Les Scales over the line at Peterborough to take the yellow jersey. And although time trialing is a British speciality, the Continentals are still taking the honours. And it's a Belgian, 23-year-old Henri Guldemont, who wins, with Frenchman Tambolini second and number 13, Chiancola, clocking third fastest time to lead the race by a minute and a half. The first major climb of the tour comes on the third day, as the riders pass from Derbyshire into Yorkshire. The route lies over Holme Moss, rising 1,000 feet. It's a sturdy Yorkshire welcome for the riders, and a 30-second time bonus for the first rider over the top. The spectators who assemble on the climb may have the time to admire the rugged beauty of this scene. But for the men on the tour, there can be no appreciation of scenery when every muscle must help to push the lowest gears on the way to the summit, out of the saddle and dancing on the pedals to gain that vital advantage. To the Italians, such climbs are almost second nature, and it is number 12, Marcello Cioli, who leads the way at the top, threading his way through the crowd of cheering spectators. He is 20 seconds ahead of Frenchman Bale, who later catches the Italian on the fast run down to Huddersfield, and then leaves him behind as he presses on to win the stage at Leeds. But the field, strung out by the day's climbing, is still fighting its way singly, and in small groups, to the top of Holme Moss. In third position comes the leading Englishman, Doug Petty, appropriately enough a Yorkshireman. He is followed 40 seconds later by Londoner Ron Jowers. And still they come, now minutes down on the leaders, but with the consolation that once they've overcome this climb, the remaining 40 miles of the stage are almost all downhill. Fifth rider at the top is the Belgian Nestor Mathieu, followed 20 seconds later by Ken Russell, Dave Bedwell, Brian Robinson and Frank Garvey. They are now nearly 2 minutes down on Cioli. More arrivals at the top of the climb, Tambolini, France, with Monty and Raymond Holiday. Then number 24, Ian Steele, and number 56, Ian Brown from Lancashire. And here are Maitland, Newman and Ilsley, followed by Greenfield, Wood and Talbot. Notable group, including number 20, Gordon Thomas, who is trying to improve his position in the general classification. And so the great cavalcade of riders and helpers passes on, with one great climb passed, but many more tests of endurance ahead. The start of the fourth stage from Leeds brings news of the retirement, through illness and injuries, of Chiancola and Cioli. But with Guldemont of Belgium wearing the yellow jersey, and Monty and Tambolini in the runner-up positions, the Continentals are still at the head of affairs. From Leeds to Scarborough is only 104 miles. The roads are fairly flat and there is a following wind, so a fast day's racing is in prospect. It's not long before the action starts, with a group forcing the pace at the front. And it's the British riders who are taking the initiative on this day's journey across the country of the Broad Acres to a well-earned day of rest on the North Sea coast. There is a small bunch of riders out in front. Behind them, but still ahead of the main field, are the leading pursuers. The tall, athletic figure of number 24, the Scotsman Steele, is prominent in this group, forcing the pace in an effort to pull back the fugitives. Number 20, Gordon Thomas, is there too, smaller in size, but no less energetic and forceful than Steele, as he plays his part in the hard chase. And here is the basis of the breakaway group that eventually builds up into the leader bunch of 24 riders at the stage finish. Bob Maitland, Brian Robinson, Don Wilson, Bedwell and Pottier. Later in the day they are joined by others, but only one Continental will be amongst them. Today, the advantage must be pressed home with every ounce of energy. There can be no easing by the riders at the front, and the pace is kept cracking at just under 30 miles an hour, countering the determined pursuit that is only a short way behind. And at Scarborough, Clive Parker of the Hercules team scores the first British stage win, covering the 104 miles in 4 hours, 2 minutes, 5 seconds. And John Pottier of the Wherewell team takes the yellow jersey from the Continentals. The rest day is well earned, and Scarborough has a ready welcome for the tour as it pauses before taking the road north and continuing the battle, which has already witnessed some surprising changes of fortune. After only 4 days of racing, the whole picture of the tour has changed. At first, the Continental riders showed almost unbeatable form, and the Italians in particular set a standard of riding that seemed likely to crush all opposition. Now, as the tour rests for a day, we can take stock with renewed hope. The Continental Challenge has been met and beaten, and British riders hold the first 4 places. With number 31, John Pottier, wearing the yellow jersey, the tour speeds on to Newcastle for another British win by Dave Bedwell, who is now second to Pottier in the general classification. As the tour approaches Scotland, there's an early breakaway from the riders seeking the honour of being first up the steep climb to Carter Bar and on over the border into Scotland. It's a lonely road over the Cheviot Hills, with the nearest town many miles from Carter Bar. But the welcoming crowds are there, Scots and English, ready to encourage the riders on this stiff climb. There's a 30-second bonus for the first man over the line at the top, as well as a useful cash prize. But they're hard-earned rewards. Down to bottom gear as the gradient stiffens, and thrusting at the pedals, the leaders force on. Guldimont, Ilsley and Bale are at the front. Guldimont suddenly makes his effort and jumps away. Ilsley is with him, but the Frenchman can hold them no longer and has quickly tailed off. And at the top, Arthur Ilsley leads the way from the Belgian Guldimont, who is heading a determined continental counterattack. Here is a chasing group, too late for the Prime Award, but intent on catching the breakaways ahead. The main body of the field, equally determined in the pursuit.
There's a warm Scottish welcome for the race as it crosses the border, for we Scots are always ready to appreciate a tough contest and to applaud a worthy winner. We're seeing some fine riding today from the men from across the sea, from the English riders, aye, and from the Scots too. Glasgow, the crowds turn out to cheer Guldimont and Bale, the first to arrive after leading for over 140 miles. Now Dave Bedwell finishes with Wyszynski, Thomas and Parker. And although the first 3 places in the stage are won by Continentals, without a Scotsman among the leaders, we're full of praise for Dave Bedwell, who is now leading the race by 4 seconds. The visit to Scotland is all too brief, for today the riders set out again for the south, back into England on the way to Wales. They travel a historic road to the border at Gretna Green, for the route takes them through the land where cycling was born. A few miles across the hills from Beatock lies the village of Thornhill, where in 1839, Kirkpatrick Macmillan conceived the idea of fitting pedal levers to a hobby horse. If he could but watch this great cavalcade today, he'd indeed appreciate the wording on the plaque erected on his old smithy. He builded better than he knew. But our riders have no time to think of the past. For them, the only concern is the road ahead, swinging down from the heights of Bedwell to the English border at Gretna Green. It's a fast day, and we Scots have a special cheer for our countryman, Ian Greenfield, who is leading the tour back to England. We hope for big things from this tall, elegant rider. Man over the border into England, he's back with the regrouped field as they pass on to the steep climb to the top of Shap Fell, a magic name in the history of British long-distance cycling. It's a tough road over the moors of the border country, and the field takes the long climb without splitting.
Bedwell leads the tour by 1.5 minutes when the riders sign on for the 125-mile run from Morecambe to Llandudno. There's an air of tension as the final preparations are made for a day's racing that will bring the tour into Wales for its second and last rest day. With over 900 racing miles behind them and still nearly 700 miles to go, every vital move in the race is followed, not only by the crowds at the roadside, but by thousands who watch the progress of the race from newspaper reports. Here at the starting control is Bruno Monti, the stocky Italian, and BSA team man Arthur Ilsley. And here's Midlander Alan Ashmore with the Viking Cycles team. Bob Maitland, the BSA captain, signs the control sheet. And here's Gordon Thomas, wearing a slightly anxious look as he dons his identity disc. Dave Bedwell has an air of quiet confidence, though, but it'll be a hard fight for the Hercules rider to hold his lead against the very determined opposition. Here's Ian Greenfield, leader of the Wherewell team, who are lying second in the tour. Yes, there's plenty to interest the spectators, even before the riders get underway. With race leader Bedwell at the front, the Mayor of Morecambe raises the starting flag. And off they go. The riders show little effect of the grueling miles they have covered as they start the vital eighth stage that brings such a reversal of fortunes, with Bedwell losing his lead and Brian Robinson taking the yellow jersey.
After a rest day at Llandudno, it's hills all the way to Cheltenham. And with a hard day's racing and the race so open, there's plenty of action and excitement for the Welsh spectators. Bedwell is trying hard to regain the race lead, and his stocky figure is prominent near the front of the field. On the last stage, Bedwell missed a vital breakaway when rivals, well-placed in the race classification, launched a devastating attack during the Morecambe to Llandudno stage. But today, he's ready for anything, and in particular, the chance to pull back some of his 20-minute deficit. It's not long before a successful breakaway develops, and Ian Greenfield leads the way through the feeding station at Nescliff, shortly before the race leaves Wales and crosses the border to Shrewsbury. Empty biddens are hurriedly flung to the roadside as fresh supplies of food and drink are handed up. A missed feed can mean a most unpleasant journey, and there's strict concentration on the business in hand from all the helpers. Four men are away now: Greenfield, Bedwell, Ilsley and Les Wilson. And to Bedwell goes the honour of crossing the English border first.
On to the stage finish at Cheltenham, where a big crowd sees Bedwell sprint across the line to recapture 5 minutes of the time he lost so disastrously 2 days before. With three stages to go, the route winds out of Cheltenham into the Cotswolds, moving south through Somerset to Devonshire's largest coastal resort, Torquay. As the tour moves on as a compact field, Brian Robinson, holding a race lead of 1.5 minutes, wears the yellow jersey. Through historic Bath, with still 100 miles to go on the day's stage, the field is splitting up. It's fine country for racing, with undulating roads that can lead to successful breakaways. But with the end of the tour only 2 days away, team managers have issued their instructions for careful watching of rival teams' moves. Crowds of holidaymakers lining the road to the finish at Torquay, one stage ends with a successful breakaway. With a powerful finishing sprint, Chitty of Italy crosses the line first, just ahead of Donald Wilson. But the overall result of the stage brings little change in the general classification. Torquay to Bournemouth, with number 17, Brian Robinson of the Ellis Briggs team, wearing the yellow jersey, is the vital stage where the attack that brings final victory will be launched. Again, it's a hilly stage for the decisive struggle between the leading teams in the race. Brian Robinson's hold on the yellow jersey will be subjected to a sharp attack from the BSA team. On a stage like this, with the whole field in an aggressive mood, the best place to be is right at the front, and that's where we find number 20, Thomas, and number 19, Maitland, waiting for the decisive moment to make their final effort. There is an increased air of urgency about this stage, but tomorrow is the last day, and gains and losses now attain greater importance than ever before. It's not long before Tiny Thomas is on the attack. This is his day, and he puts everything he can into his effort, reaping his reward with a stage win at Bournemouth that gives him the yellow jersey of the race leader, 4.5 minutes ahead of Werwell's Les Scales. Bournemouth, the last stage, and 120 miles to go. Can the yellow-jerseyed Thomas and the BSA team repulse the attacks that are bound to come on this final section through the New Forest, across Surrey, and on to Wembley? The answer is here, for Thomas is never far from the front with his teammates close by, watchful and alert. Attempts by other teams to get away are stopped by Thomas's watchdogs, who have no intention of letting victory slip from their grasp. Along leafy roads in bright sunshine, they ride steadily towards London, where thousands of people await their arrival. The tour has its finish at Wembley, and the main field, including the tour leaders, is now due, and crowds of enthusiasts arrive early to welcome the riders in this great test of endurance. And here they come, with a Belgium Grandoliers in the lead and the massed field close behind. But it's a great victory for Thomas, and his BSA teammates have reason to be pleased. But let us not forget the gallant losers. Bedwell, the king of the mountains, and the Italians, who would never admit defeat. We leave Thomas and his team to receive the acclaim they so richly deserve. Theirs are the honors in but one phase of this great cycling game. A game which provides scope for all, the leisurely minded as well as the speed man. The tour has taken them along roads well worn by the wheels of fellow cyclists, roads which have carried them across this great heritage of ours. And what better way to go than this, touring through the beauty that is Britain.